in that read the comments, I mean the message in that I posted in the WhatsApp group, right? So according to that, I'm just planning the lecture, okay? So yes, so the point is that I'm really looking forward to your cooperation, because you know online things are much more difficult nowadays, but still we can work it on. And I just wanted to make a friendly environment. I'm just here to really share things, not really teach, but I'm here to share this thing. As I said in the message, I would like to present everything so that I will stay here for another half an hour to 40 minutes maybe after this lecture, and there that time you can recall. Out of this 4 talk, it is quite not easy task to, you know, recall the group theoretical ideas, many things, because I done entire semester course on this. Especially I love group theory and it is very huge, but still I love to give the essence. And this lecture is, I'm not going to really solve many questions, but I will solve very important questions so that you can go and look at some particular place wherever I am saying, and those questions you can able to solve, especially NBHM pattern type of questions. Okay, so with these things, my lecture planning is this. I will recall few definitions, and I'm really trying to give you a glimpse about research. In research, what we used to do recently, there are research progression is going on, and I will tell you about this. That type of question is this: what can you say about a subgroup of subgroup of Z? It's sort of a research type of question. Okay, and I'm planning to solve these two questions. This is asked in IIT interview. This is asked in my IMSC interview. So all of these materials are carefully chosen, so that will give you many aspects of this competitive exam, not only NBHM CSIR, but also a next level of exam in IITs and research type of questions. So what we do, I like to present this kind of things, okay? And after that, I wanted to also come down and clearly show the things that I'm like, the basics things, so that some of you really far away from the basic learning also can learn. Okay, so I just expect you to cooperate and listen carefully, and I will be here after this class and you can ask a lot of questions. Okay, shall I start?
Sure. So please change the view into landscape mode. Maybe
it is in landscape. It's okay. Already in landscape. I didn't make it big. Okay, now it's okay, right? Oh. Big.
Now it's okay.
Yeah, this is the maximum big I can do, I think. Okay, so the thing is that I wanted to classify the groups of Z. This is a research type of question, but it will help us to understand many things. You will see why I am doing this in a moment. In the class is mostly theoretical part, and the next class is the link to this class is mostly a concrete example things. Okay, there you will see some kind of computations also involved. So it's mostly recalling the basics, but still I made it in a way so that it is accessible. It's not a normal lecture. Normal lecture, people usually state the theorem and prove the theorem. But really, we are doing different here. We are trying to catch entire theory part by doing investigating the questions. Okay, remember this word, investigation and inquiry. These words are very, very important. And I wanted to add one more word, look like. In algebra, look like as a own power. Okay, this word comes again and again, look like, okay? It will be very, very clear with respect to the context. What really look like, what I mean. I will explain you. For example, subgroups looks like in Z. What kind of, like, if you take a subgroup, how it looks like? Looks like means, can you give a very nice formula, nice format, or I can visualize, or I can see really like that. But when I use some in the concepts of group, I am usually says isomorphism in isomorphic sense. Okay, now, so let's go through this. I will answer one by one. Let's go through what's happening. Okay, these are the standard definition. I just wanted to start. I don't know where to start because all of them are a mixed audience are there. So I basically love to start with the standard definitions. So let G be the group. I assume that you know everyone knows about group that I insist also you to read that. So G Vidas group, and I'm saying that the smallest n where this becomes identity, one I always means identity. Okay, this is our agreement. I use one for identity of the group, and it will be clear which group I'm talking about. Okay, fine. Now, subgroup generated by G looks like this, G power n, where n varies over integer. If group is abelian, I'm using plus. Okay, that is also our agreement. Plus is for abelian. In the sense, we always, in higher mathematics, we work in plus, because it's useful to understand like this module. So it's plus is very nice, and instead of a star. Okay. I say cyclic group generated by G means it's just generated by G means the smallest subgroup containing G. It can be described in a way like this, like in the way, okay. And if G is as an infinite order, and I will say this is infinite group, subgroup generated by G. If it is finite order, I will say finite cyclic group. Okay, let us spend 1 or 2 minutes why this is called cyclic, okay. The word cyclic is very, very important, shows up in many places of mathematics. The word cyclic means it's a singly generated. Singly generated means if you start a graph, let's say this is G, this is G square, this is G cube, go on, you can come back in a finite set. After G power n, you will get an identity. It's roughly means, or really means, you can control the entire group just by one single element. Okay, that is called cyclicness. That's why the cyclic groups are very, very important. And I'm telling you, the right place to start group theory is cyclic group, because two of the questions really not about cyclic group, but the way we are answering it will turn into cyclic group. That's why I started with the cyclic group. The real hierarchy is cyclic group, abelian group, nilpotent group, solvable group. Okay, now I'm sure you may not understand this in a lot, but we will see how things are going. I will clearly talk about each and everything in a later talks. So right where to start, where we have to start, cyclic group. There are a lot of examples of cyclic group, but I prefer to give these two examples only. I will tell you why. You must have seen this example. I will justify why I am restricting my attention to just Z and Zn. There are, for example, in S1, the circle in a complex plane, cube root of unity, fourth root of unity, in general, nth root of unity is there. All of them are cyclic, finite cyclic group. But why I am preferring this, you will see in this talk. Okay. So I'm mostly working in a general setup of thing. And if G is a finite cyclic group, this is the power. Just to account it. We know this already. Just to account it. Okay. If G is infinite, then you see it start with the g square and goes on in this direction. Similarly, it's 1, g minus minus 1, g minus 2 goes on in this direction. Okay, remember always that z is underlying playing a role. So the real object is z. Let's look at the definition. The real object, you see, z is somewhere underlying and playing a role. So that's why I am restating my thing to here. Okay, let's see. This is also, I insist you to read. This is the first isomorphism theorem. It says that whenever you have a surjective map, this symbol, remember that in the entire talk, this symbol means surjective. This symbol means injective. This symbol means injective. This symbol means surjective. So if I use together, this is called bijective. It's a shorthand notation. Whenever you have a surjective homomorphism, group homomorphism, then G by kernel of phi is isomorphic to the image. This we are going to use it. This is going to be a key part in this lecture, okay? So this is what I wanted to recall. This is a standard definition. So these are like easy. Let's go on and say about subgroups of Z, okay? So in research, people usually classify things, how it looks like in algebra, especially algebra, how things are look like. They ask a lot of questions, how things are looks like. Can we do something so that it looks nicely? For example, in this question, we are asking, we are inquiring, I have Z, because I just said in entire cyclic group, somewhat this Z underplaying a role. So I would like to understand more about Z, so that in the definition, this play of Z is very important so that I can do something. So let us understand the group Z. So understanding the group Z is understanding the subgroups also very nice. The first thing is that I'm climbing. This is an exercise. This is easy. NZ. NZ, small Z. Small Z from com. This is subgroup. Like for example, 2Z. 2Z looks like 0 plus or minus 2 plus or minus 4 like that. Let's say 5Z. 5Z looks like 0 plus or minus 5 goes on. So first you try to prove this is a subgroup, which is easy. Just you have to directly try it, okay? Now, the reverse, little bit hard, comparatively, relatively, not that hard. I'm asking converse question. What is a converse question? Is every subgroup of Z looks like this? That means I will give you a subgroup of Z. This is a standard notation for subgroup. Is there any way using this subgroup, can I find N such that it looks like NZ? H looks like NZ. It is true. It is indeed true. This is the first nice thing that we are getting. Every subgroup looks like this. This not only a subgroup, but all the subgroups looks like this, where N runs over natural number union zero. That's just whole numbers. Okay. Let us try to understand a bit more about that. So I like to prove the reverse, as I said. Before that, let's recalling of a well-ordering principle of natural number. What is the well-ordering principle of natural number? It's 1, 2, dot, 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 dot. It's going, right? Natural number. You take any subset which is non-empty. It has a smallest number. Take any subset of natural number. It has a smallest number. That's the well-ordering principle, okay? With respect to that, I'm going to prove it. Let us prove. Case 1. If H is a subgroup of Z and H is empty, trivial, then it is easy, right? 0Z and 0 belongs to natural number union 0. 0Z nothing but just 0 and H looks like 0Z. I'm done. The second part, if listen carefully, this is a key trick. You have to, one of my teacher always says, you have to remember the statement and the key point. Then all of them will follow easily. If you are fond of reading Michael Artin book, you will know that he always says what to prove in mathematics is very, very important. Then more or less how to prove will come. Okay. So here also we will use that. Listen carefully. H is a non-trivial group. That means it has a belongs to H, a not equal to zero. So it is inside a Z. So A must be positive or negative. That means minus A is positive or negative. Either A positive or minus A is positive. Correct, right? If it is minus 2, minus of minus 2 is plus 2. Either A is positive or minus A is negative. That says that natural number intersection H is not empty. What I am saying here, if I am having a non-zero number, then this group is kind of symmetry. A will be there, 2A will be there, everything will be there, minus 2A will be there, something, 4A will be there, I mean 3A will be there. So natural number intersection, this is empty. Just now we see, and I'm telling you, whenever you have a subset of natural number, always try to think of this well-ordering principle. We have a natural number and a subset of natural number which is non-empty. Then think of well-ordering principle. There exists N. So there exists N such that N is smallest inside N H. So that is the problem of us, and if now the problem almost solved. I asked you the question, is every subgroup looks like this? So start with a subgroup. The real problem finding that N. now we had find the n. We had find the n. So we had find the n, right? So now let us see how this n will help us. So n z will inside h. That means n is inside h. 2n will be inside, n plus n will be 3n. So this side, 3n, 5n, everything will be inside h. And the negative of also inside h. So nz inside h. Climb. This nz actually equal to h. Remember the smallest, the word is very, very important, which we are going to use. We are not yet chosen that, but we are going to use. Okay, let a small a belongs to h. If you are familiar with a little bit of number theory, it is easy. N is not equal to 0. Standard proof only. N is not equal to 0. Then A can be written as N Q plus R, where R is greater than or equal to, there are two things. R equal to 0 or R greater than 0 less than N. Remember that this A belongs to H. N belongs to H, hence NQ belongs to H. This implies A minus NQ belongs to H, which is nothing but R. And you see, R must be 0. If R is not 0, R is less than N, R is belongs to H. R must be the smallest. R must be the smallest. And we say the N is the smallest one, and this contradicts. That implies, since N is smallest, R equal to 0. That implies A equal to NQ. See, before the talk, in the starting of the talk, I said look like. And I showed that every element A look like NQ. That shows that H is.
I
don't
know.
Hello? Is there any something?
No. You continue.
Oh, okay. Maybe. Fine. Okay. So this is the thing. It looks like, so finally what happened? NZ. So we done something really great. I'm telling you, this is one of the interview question. How one approaches to the classification problem, okay? These are the kind of classification problem. In algebra, people mostly tries to see the concrete examples. Then they will say, what condition so that the general abstraction becomes a concrete example, okay? There are, now I'm doing in research in that area only, in planar algebras. We used to deal with this kind of thing. Recently, one of my senior defended, and our first paper is like seeing the structure of certain class of matrix algebra. Okay, so it's really better to understand this kind of basic thing so that those words, when people say, when good speakers say, it won't be a big issue. Okay. So we have done. So finally, what we have done, we classified every subgroup looks like NZ, and N varies over natural number union 0. And these are the only subgroups of integers. Okay. And N equal to 1, Z itself an integer. Okay. These are the subgroups. Okay. Let us move on. So I answered the first question, which I started with. Let us move on. So this is what I have written here. Let us move on. This is also very nice. Every cyclic group is isomorphic to either Z or Zn, which is I'm claiming. So generally cyclic groups written like this, it's like G power N such that N belongs to Z. And you see there are something, it's played by Z. So that's what I'm saying. And that is a particularly, that is a very basic reason why I gave you only two examples. And these examples are concrete. I don't want to get you deviated with other example, because essentially this look like Zeta Zn. And remember that I'm again using the word look like in a rough sense. Here look like means two groups are look like means as isomorphism, I'm saying. Okay, here little difference, but more or less the structurally the word is very important, right? So I'm claiming it is Z or Zn. So I will tell you in the end of the lecture, we are going to deal a very, very different problem, which does not appear in any exams as far as I know. And that question seems to be very hard initially, but if you know this thing, this theorem, it will be extremely easy. Okay, let's do that. It's very simple. First, what I'm doing, take Z and group G. Let G be a cyclic group. So I am sending N to G power N. The cyclic group generated by one element, right? And we know how it looks like. G power N such that N belongs to Z. And you see that here N1 plus N2 goes to here N1 plus N2, which is GN1 GN2. So it seems that it's a homomorphism. So, and also it's onto homomorphism. This implies, let's say phi, phi is homomorphism. And you see this is onto because every element looks like G power N. That is a definition. This is onto homomorphism. Because I said every element looks like this. So that means G by parallel of phi is isomorphic to G. We are done. That's it. The first, because remember this theorem? First isomorphism theorem. First isomorphism theorem. Using this theorem, if you are familiar with that theorem, this is done. But just now, remember just now we saw every subgroup of Z looks like NZ. NZ is isomorphic to G. So when N equal to zero, this is just Z. If N greater than zero, G is isomorphic to Zn, which is by definition Z by NZ. That's it. These are not very big thing. These are very small thing and looks very scary. When I was in BSc also, I thought that what these people are doing, what this is going, this they say N. But later on in a higher studies, it becomes very easy. That's why I said I'm here really to share, not to scare you. Okay. Fine. This is easy, right? You can believe that now this is easy. Just using two or three facts, things are easy. And we have done a very great thing. What we have done here, this set is an abstract group and this set is a concrete group. We have this set is G, anything, it can be anything. As said theoretically, it can be flowers, it can be people in a necessarily different, maybe different binary operation. But this side we have Z and Zn's. So it's a very concrete. We know Zn very well. And we know how the things are looks like, how to control it. So in the end of the lecture, I have included five statements, which are very, very common statement, which are a small theorem in a regular standard book. And we are going to answer everything just one line using these ideas. Okay. So far, let me pause a break and recall what we have done. We have recalled the basic definitions of cyclic group. Using that, we have seen that somewhat Z plays a role underneath role. So using the Z, we are trying to understand the Z. In the trying to understand Z, it's better to understand the subgroup of Z, which is Z, NZ. N belongs to natural number union zero. Then using that, we came up with a very nice thing. We classified, and this is called the fundamental theorem of cyclic groups. Okay, just two, three lines, that's it. Fundamental theorem of cyclic groups. It essentially says that every group G looks like Z or Zn. If you have a very nice standard book, they must mention this theorem as a fundamental theorem of cyclic group. Okay. Now I am throwing another word, fundamental. Okay. Fundamental means very, very important. Okay. In algebra, when you, the serious problem in reading the text, very nice text, people, great people say this textbook is very nice, that textbook is very nice, because they enjoy this kind of wording. They enjoy this kind of wording, means they use this kind of wordings. They say in the textbook, recently I'm reading a textbook on pre-probability, the author uses very nice words which are used in lectures. Then I check the title of the book, it says that lectures in pre-probability. So this kind of words you have to get familiar with. Then the books are very friendly, not scary. I have asked one of some of my friends. They said that the foreign author books are very bad because it looks like this kind of word they use, we didn't know. It's a really our problem to not understand. So remember that I have used some words like look like fundamental. These words are going to play a vital role. Okay, let me continue. So let us answer the question which I start with, the second question. Let G be the group such that G has finitely many subgroups. Okay, let G be the group such as finitely many subgroups. What can you say about G? I wanted you to pay really attention to this question. We are going to answer in a minute. But more than answer, I would like you to really understand this question. There is a reason. I will tell you why I am just putting this question in the first place. Number one, this is my IMSC interview question, number one. Number two, while in interview, I really understood it in a wrong way. The question asked by my guide, and he said in the interview, you did not even understand the question. First, understand the question. So I want you to understand the question, okay? Let's understand this question. Let G be the group such that G has finitely many subgroups. Remember that they are not saying each subgroup is finite, but they are saying finitely many group. That number of subgroup is finite. And they ask, what can you say about G? Just like that, they are asking, what can you say about the G? And this question initially seems, we are not having any head and tail, where to start. But the key is the number. So nothing but they are asking just cardinality of G. Okay. And yes, you can guess it, the cardinality must be finite, and we will see why. And I would like to approach exactly the way I approached in the interview. Then I remodified. Okay, I will see how I approached in the interview. This is I'm sharing. And I guessed the right question. I said that G must be finite, and they said very good, it's correct. Just try to prove. Yes, let's try to prove. G suppose having an element. I told you, remember that I told you, starting with the right way to start is correct. The right way to start is the right place in cyclic groups. That is the right way. So I also started with that. I said there is no infinite order in the group. They said, okay, prove it. If there is an element of order infinite, that means G power N is not equal to 1 for any N belongs to Z except 0. That means it's infinite cyclic group sitting inside. That means this is isomorphic to infinite cyclic group. That means a copy of Z, this word, note this word, copy of Z. Many foreign authors, other authors use this, a copy of Z inside. It means G as a copy of Z. And we know Z has infinitely many subgroup, right? Each Zn is there. So that is a subgroup here, a copy of a subgroup here for each n. So it has an infinitely many subgroup. So that contradicts the finitely many thing. So this is not going to happen. And they said, okay, very good. Then I said, hence we can somewhat say G is finite. No, they said, this is not enough. This is not enough. What I just proved, each element in G is as a finite order. That's it. That's how I prove. I would like to present the warning. This is not enough. This is an example. This is a standard example. P of X is a power set of X with respect to the symmetric difference. That means AB. Symmetric difference of A symmetric difference B, A minus B union B minus A. This is symmetric difference. Try to prove that. Just put in the definition, you will see A square equal to A symmetric difference A, which is empty. Empty is the identity. So it's identity. That means A square equal to identity for every A. That means every element has a order 2, except identity. X identity is the 1 and every rest of the element is order 2. Then if X is a infinite, then P of X is also infinite. So we have an example of a group which is infinite, but each and every element is order 2, which is the minimal possible except identity. Identity is 1. Okay, so we need a more idea. Then I have turned. What I have done? This is the way I have turned. I wanted to prove contrapositive method. Let us show that if G is infinite, then it has infinitely many subgroups. If I prove that, then if something has finitely many subgroups, it necessarily must be finite. Okay. Am I audible clearly?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I make so much sense. Okay, if G is infinite, okay, you see that G is infinite, Z is sitting inside G, then we are done. G is infinite, I'm starting with an infinite subgroup, Z is sitting inside, Z has many NZs, so that's it, it has many subgroups. But in our case, G is infinite, but G has all finite order elements. Okay, that means each G belongs to G, order of this is finite. In this case, you see, I choose an element and I generate a cyclic subgroup. Remember that the question is for general group, but I am still attacking with a cyclic group. That's what I say, the right place to start is a cyclic group. You see that in the content of a standard pages, you will see that everything is like started with a cyclic group, simplest structure. So understanding the simplest structure, okay? So this is one such group, let it call C1 for cyclic sake. And this is finite, right? Because order of G is finite. This is finite, but this is infinite. So there will be G2, which is does not belongs to C1, and G2 belongs to G. So go with G2. Generate, this is C2. See, this is finite, this is finite, union of finite is finite, but G is still infinite, there will be G3. Then I will go G3. Call it C3. So now 1, 2, 3. So this is finite, this is finite, this is finite. So union of three finite set is finite. So in this way, I go and produce infinitely many subgroups. Each and every time, nth time, let's say nth iteration, I will have n finitely many subgroups. So union of finitely many subgroups is finite. So G is still infinite. So I keep on go. So n's G is finite if we set G as finitely many subgroups. So this is the interview question. Okay, we have solved a very nice interview question. Okay, very good, nice. We can appreciate ourselves. Okay, this is exactly the way I proceed. I could have proceeded in this way, but they give me a hint, they comfort me really. So it was one of the nice experience which I like to share. I shared also. So let us answer the other question. Precisely two subgroups. Precisely two subgroups. Okay, G has precisely two subgroups. Means let us pause a moment and try to understand what it means in a numbers. Take a natural number. Take a natural number and it has a precisely two divisors. Means it is prime number, correct? It is not one because one has a one divisor. Precisely two divisors means it is prime number. Exactly the same kind of question I am asking. G has precisely two subgroups. What can you say about G or how G looks like? G is certainly not trivial. Trivial groups are just one number. So there is only one subgroup itself. So G is certainly not trivial, that we know. Same idea. So G cannot contain Z because Z has many number of subgroups. G cannot contain Zn as a subgroup because when N is composite, Zn has many things. The same idea. G either contains Z or Zn's. Z is not possible. Z is N also not possible for composite number because Zn, converse of Lagrange's theorem holds. For each divisor of N, there is a subgroup. So the only way it contains is prime number Zp. That means what I'm saying, you fix a G belongs to G, generate a subgroup, this must be equal to G because it has a non-trivial element. A non-trivial element. There's a non-trivial element, generate a G. Exactly two subgroups are there. One is identity, another one is self. So I am having equality here. Okay, equality here. Okay, so this Zn, N cannot be, this is equal to Zn because of the finite property. So as I said, Z cannot sit inside because of infinite problem. So Zn only can sit in and it is composite number. It cannot be composite number because every composite divisors of N, there exists a subgroup. So N must be prime number. So it looks like Zp. Remember that. That question we have asked for general group, but it stands out to be a Zp. This is one of the very nicest problem in Michael Artin book. People really ask this kind of questions in the interviews. Okay. Fine. Okay. Let me continue. Okay. So I will pause a moment and I will say what we have done so far. First, we started with the group. Okay. The definitions of the cyclic group. Then we see there is a nice thing about Z, which is underlying. So when the Z is underlying, we are trying to understand the subgroups of Z. And we say that it is NZ. Then slowly we classified that thing. And using this as excuses, we have recalled well-ordering principle, some ideas of the group, all those things, okay? Then we have understood that any subgroup of Z is of the form NZ. Using that, we classified on a nice theorem, which is called fundamental theorem of cyclic group. Every cyclic group, if it is infinite, it must be looks like Z. In particular, NZ is again isomorphic to Z. So this is happening very nice. Like in an infinite setup, there are a lot of things which is, let's pause a moment to understand this. Isomorphic to Z for every N belongs to natural number. Remember, it is not zero. Zero is just zero. NZ isomorphic to Z for every N belongs to natural number. This is not possible in finite case. Do you see that? Because every proper subset is strictly cardinality less than the original set. So it is not possible, but in the infinite, it is possible. So we have to be very careful whenever we are dealing with infinite. Somewhere that finiteness will help us. For example, no proper subgroup of Zn, let's say Zm, which is isomorphic to Zn, just because of set theoretical idea. But this is happening. This is one of the note. Okay, people can ask this kind of question. Is there any group whose isomorphic to its own proper subgroups? There are groups. One of the example is NZ. Okay. You can choose 3, you can choose 4, you can choose anything as large as you want. As long as there is a natural number, this happens. But this is not true in finite sense. Okay. Then we ask the question, which is my interview question. Let G be a group such that G has finitely many subgroups. What can you say about G? And that number shows, gave me idea, G is finite. And we slowly shows that using the cyclic, no big ideas, just cyclic, using cyclic ideas, we showed. On the way, this important example we have learned, and this is one of the important example which is help us to do in lot of counterexamples, Wachs's counterexample, and we have learned, and which is sort of very important in measure theory. Recently, one of my friend in number theory, his name is Karthik, he's also one of the resource person. His work actually dealing with some sort of subset, which is a subset of this thing, and he proved that that subset is actually, with respect to symmetric difference, is subgroup. They are some nice hi-fi times, Chebbitrow density type of sets. So he defined some kind of sets, and he proved the subset of this, and it's number theory, very much number theory, and it's a subgroup actually proved. Okay, because of that, there was a lot of advantage in doing computations. Okay, recent work. Okay, let us after that, we asked the one question, precisely two subgroups, then what can you say about G? That means the question really, what G looks like? The G looks like essentially ZP. That's what we have done. Okay. So now, after combining all these things, let us pause and understand the statement one by one. These are the standard statements. And let us first understand one by one. Okay, every cyclic group is abelian. You will go, if I ask you to prove, you will say, okay sir, G take n1, G take n2, you multiply, you will get gn1 plus gn2, then gn2 plus gn1, because that integer, then gn2, gn1, like this you will go. But I won't go like this. I will say essentially it looks like z or zn. So both are abelian. So everything is abelian. That's what I do. I will just give you my answer like, essentially looks like Z or Zn. So everything is abelian. That's it. I won't go into the computation. That's why we are using this theorem. These theorems are giving us more powerful tools. We have to use this theorem. If you know the proof of the theorem, definitely you should use it. If somebody asks me this question, cyclic groups are abelian, I will say it looks like Z or Zn. Yeah, if you go for the formal proof, you will go for like this, right? You will take two elements that looks like gn and gm and gn plus m, and you will go for gm plus n. What you are using here? Again, the property of Z, indirectly, implicitly. Then you will say gn and gm, so it is like this is A, this is B, now we are getting B and A. But why don't you use this? Because we now have more power. It looks like Z or Zn, both are abelian, so it is abelian. Okay. All the subgroups of cyclic groups is cyclic. Again, what you do generally, you will take a subgroup of G, and you will say that if it is trivial, it's okay. If it is non-trivial, I will show that there exists a G. If you try it, okay. Let me illustrate how that goes. Okay, let me illustrate the general proof, why this is much better than the general proof. In a general proof, if I ask you to prove something is cyclic and subgroup of cyclic group is cyclic, you will say, okay, let's take G power N belongs to H. Generally, they goes for n such that g power n belongs to h. Okay, n belongs to natural number. And they will say this is non-empty. First, they will say this is non-empty. Okay, they will say this is non-empty. Or one second, let me use a very precise notation. I will tell you what. I will take n belongs to natural number union 0, because that is also a possibility, such that g power n belongs to h. Because identity is there, one is there. So if g power 0 is 1, so 0 is there, this is non-empty. At least g power is there. And well-ordering principle also holds. If you add one number, it's not a problem. This well-ordering principle holds here. Then you will say choose smallest. Choose smallest such that smallest n such that choose smallest n, that's it, not such that, just choose smallest n, and you say that g power n generates h, and you will do that again. The essentially the calculation, what we are doing for that the calculation, you will take a element a belongs to h, you will say like this, once again See, remember, this is just single element. You will say that A belongs to H looks like G power N into M, some M, you will say. Okay. But you know that A belongs to H, looks like G power some K, and we have G power N on another side. This N, and we, N is, let's say, greater than zero. If you choose it a non-trivial group, same idea you will repeat, N greater than zero, then K can be divided as NQ plus R, R equal to zero, one choice, R greater than zero, less than N. And exactly the way I argued for Z, you will argue it. And you will say R must be zero, the K looks like NQ. Once you say K looks like NQ, G over Q. So this becomes H, and this looks like, again, this thing. So you will say H is G power N. This is how the general proof goes. If you ask me, after all the work we have done, I will say like all subgroups of cyclic group is cyclic because essentially it looks like Z. We know all the Z subgroups of Z, that is NZ. So cyclic, done. If it is infinite, we are done. If it is finite, Zn, in that case also we are done. It's very easy to see it. We will see in the later in this talk how to see the subgroups of Zn, okay? And a converse of Lagrange's theorem holds also, I will demonstrate, okay? I am looking forward to that, but now let's at least trust me. If somebody asks this question to me, I will say it is Z or Zn, and I know all the subgroup of Zn, so that are cyclic because Nz, and this is also easy. It's a finite thing. So it's very concrete to work in here, okay? Then there. So these two statements are fine. Now, this is a very nice thing. This is not direct, but I will tell you. Homomorphic image of cyclic group is cyclic. Again, in a general proof, what you do? You will go like this. You take G, and there is G dash, which is phi, which is onto homomorphism or surjective, and you will see G by kernel of phi is isomorphic to G. And I know G is cyclic. Then I have to prove G by kernel of phi for any phi is cyclic. This is a old method. You slowly do like this, and you'll show G by kernel of phi for any phi is cyclic. So that's isomorphic to G dash. This is how really a workout. But if you ask me what I will do, I will tell you. Again, I will just look forward. This is a very nice trick. Pay attention. I will say this is either Z or Zn. G looks like either Z or Zn, right? So technically, there is an onto-homomorphism always to Z. That's how we prove. Remember the proof? That's why I'm saying if you know the proof, it will be very nice. I just send N to, if G is generated by G power G, then G power N. This is how I sent you. Remember the proof. Just now illustrated. I mean, just now demonstrated. Proof. Z goes like this. And you have another thing. So initially, forget about this part. Initially, we have this. Okay, forget about this part. This is a trick I'm telling you. We have an onto homomorphism. We have an onto homomorphism from here to here. Then here to here, you have onto homomorphism. Hence, here to here, there is an onto homomorphism. Essentially, finally, this becomes again this thing. So this is again NZ. If somebody asks me, I will prove like this, just 2-3 steps. I know the idea, so just 2-3 steps. People are giving the, so I will tell you another funny fact. The funny thing is, reading this is much harder than doing the proof. Homeomorphic image of cyclic group is cyclic. I will just go, okay, what they say, there is a cyclic group, there is another cyclic group, there is a homeomorphic group. But I know already there is a thing. Then from here, so there is an onto homomorphism. So this becomes this. That's it. That's easy. Just 3 steps. So, as I said, I just don't want to recall the old steps. Even though I'm recalling the old statements, but I wanted to give a new perspective so that will be really helping you to grow, right? That really helping you to grow and see, okay, this much is easy. so that I can do that, right? So that's what I did. So that third statement is very nice. We have proved that. See how easy it is? Because we know the classification, okay? Any infinite cyclic group has precisely two generators. If you start really abstract, you will have some problem of writing. But if you ask me, I know that is Z. This statement essentially about Z. If people ask me infinite cyclic group as precisely two generator, I say, okay, infinite cyclic group looks like Z, and I will prove for Z, and it will hold for any infinite cyclic group. Let's try to prove it. How to prove it? I will prove only for Z, then it holds. Okay, let's take, I will tell you why I am doing it, because we have an advantage of multiplication in Z. Okay, it's a ring. That's how it works. You take a N. Okay, you take a N, belongs to Z, and take N, and you say N generates Z. Climb N equal to plus or minus 1. That's my claim. How? Because 1 is here. 1 equal to sum q times n. Okay, I have two number. Remember that I have two number. Little bit of number theory, you know, even in the BSc level, you know. I have two integers multiply with 1. That means n equal to 1 by q. Neither of them 0, because if you multiply 0, you will get 0. So I can write it. And you see, this is integer. This is also integer, but it looks like 1 by q form. The q must be plus or minus 1. It's not plus or minus 1. If it is 2 or something else, if it is greater than or equal to 2, or let's say less than or equal to minus 2, 1 by q mod is less than 1 by 2. Okay. It better be plus or minus 1, because both of them are integer. If it is plus or minus 1, n equal to plus or minus 1. That's it. So you see the advantage I used here. The advantage is multiplication and the properties of integer. Somewhat that Z really helping us underlying. That is very important for tomorrow's talk also. We are going to deal with the non-abelian groups. I'm giving a hint. Okay. We are going to deal with the non-abelian group very concretely, giving more examples. But still, after all reading about abelian group, why or how extend this abelian group to help us to understand non-abelian group? Okay, that is really a tomorrow's main topic. Allow me to take water, because I need water. Okay, fine. So I have used this advantage, okay? And I hope you will use this advantage in your teaching or in the research, if in this way, okay? 1, 2, 3, and we have proved the 4. The fifth statement, I will not prove here now, but we will prove. Essentially, we will prove it later in this class, okay? If time permits, I will really do it, okay? So far, lot of theory. In the use of theory, really, I mean, I'm not really doing theory. I asked 3 questions initially. Let us see. Just 3 questions. What can you say about subgroups of Z? What can you say about G, which has only 2 subgroups? What can you say about G, which has precisely finitely many subgroups? Using that, we have developed, as I promised, I have recalled the basic things of group theory, whatever needed this question. Okay. So now I'm really dealing with a very nice kind of problem which can occur in competitive exam, much common than those kind of questions. Those kind of questions occurs in the IIT second level exams or in the interviews. Okay. I'm not here really, you know, teach for CSIR class, that you could have gone to YouTube and there are a bunch of channels they are doing it. But I'm not really here to teach like that. But along with that, I wanted to teach about research also. Okay. I will tell you why in the end of the class why I like to go on that way rather than going on the usual way. Okay, fine. Let us understand this question. Okay, now I'm going to demonstrate a very nice thing. How to read the question and whether really we are understanding the each and everything. Okay, suppose p is prime number greater than 3. Remember, this is, let's say, greater than 3. Consider the multiplicative group z p z star. That means everything will come except 0. Okay, so order p minus 1, they are given. Okay, prove that the set s equal to x square such that x belongs to x is a subgroup of multiplicative group g. Okay, they say fine, let's do that first. This is I wanted to do because even though it is easy for many of you people, still I wanted to demonstrate because it is one of the most or 2-3 times occurred question in CSIRnet. Okay, I was at a MSc student, Arun Kumar Anna, they used to solve this kind of question for us, and which has helped us to understand many more questions. Okay, they used to teach me. For that, I really have to thank them. Okay, let's see. I have x square. Let's take, as I said, let us understand how things are looks like. S looks like x square such that x belongs to g. This is how x looks like. I will take a comma b belongs to s, and a looks like some x square, b looks like some y square, and this x belongs to g, y belongs to g. I would like to see some z square and z belongs to g. This is what my claim. So let us multiply x square y square. Because I am in abelian group, you know this kind of groups are abelian group, you say xy the whole square. This is xy, xy, but these are abelian group. So this is my z, z equal to xy. If it is not abelian, it is not true in general, but it is abelian group we are dealing with. So it is true, xy. So that particular z which I'm looking for, xy. So it is a subgroup. You might have noticed that I just only check the closer option. Why I am not going to check the other one, inverse option? Because this is finite. In a finite group, it's enough to check a subgroup is non-empty, as well as just you check for closeness. This is clearly a non-empty because one is belongs to here. One square is one. So you check for non-empty, then you directly go for closure. Then that property comes because of finiteness. So this is done. Okay. So determine the index G. Index S. Determine the index. Okay. Once you determine the index, you will see that. So the next thing, determine the index. I will tell you. So far, remember that this question looks very easy. When few questions I have dealt with today are not looks easy, but we turn into easy. But this question looks easy, but we still not used n greater than or equal to 3. This is a place we are going to use it. Okay, I claim. Okay, let's see how these things goes. Okay, so I want to take I want to say this is 2. Why, like how this is 2? Maybe one can try for, let's say we don't know how to approach it. So the better way to approach, we know 1 is there, 2 is there, up to p minus 1 is there, because very concrete group, zp star. So since I don't know, I wanted to really approach how these things are growing. So the 1 square is 1. This p minus 1 square is also p. And you see this occurs in pairs. Because of this, like you can see this occurs in pair. In that sense, you can give a map like this, g to plus or minus 1, x belongs to g, I send x to plus 1 if there exists y such that y square is x. And I send y, I mean, I send to x to minus 1 otherwise. You see, if there is a square root exist, I send it to 1. If not, I send it to minus 1. Okay. Now we are using the property. It's kind of a sine function. If x is 1, if it is as a square root, if x is minus 1, it doesn't. Let us check this is a homomorphism. How to check this is a homomorphism? Let's say I will take x comma y belongs to G. There are four possibility. Case 1, case 2, case 3, case 4. Both x and y square root exist. Okay, let me use a different notation, not x, y. Let me use AB. Both square root exist means AB square, right? If A is some x square, this is some y square, then this is some z square. And I know A goes for 1, B goes for 1, and AB here, if I multiply, it's like 1 into 1, it's 1. So z goes to for 1. In that sense, it is homomorphism. So the another case, A is goes for minus 1, no square root exists, B is goes for 1. If no square root exists, AB cannot be a square. If AB is some z square and B square, so B looks like x square and this is z square, A goes to z square minus, I mean, not minus, x minus square. So it will be like z x minus 1, the whole square. So A necessarily looks like this thing. So that says that 1 minus 1 will be minus 1. Z goes to, I mean, AB cannot be square. In the case, in this case, AB cannot be a square, perfect square. So this goes to minus 1. And this believable, minus 1 and plus 1 is goes to minus 1. In this case also, A is plus 1, square root exists, B is minus 1. Square does exactly same works. If A is not, this is little bit tough. This is we have to square. This is goes to minus 1. B goes to minus 1. But AB goes to plus 1. How? A is not a square. B is not a square. That means if you write A fundamentally with generators. Okay, I wanted to tell you this is also cyclic group. Okay, if you choose clearly the generator, I mean, this is a cyclic group, I'm saying. That's easy. You check it, this is a cyclic group. Maybe I will deal in the later time. So if you try for generator, this is not square, I mean, this is looks like 2k plus 1. This looks like g 2 L plus 1, but when you multiply AB, this looks like 2K plus 2L plus 2. And look at this is now. Now square. And you see minus 1, minus 1, plus 1. So this map, homomorphism. And this kernel. Kernel of phi is nothing but set of all x such that phi x equal to 1. That means there exists y square. Y that such that y square equal to x. So kernel is nothing but our S. So G by S isomorphic to plus or minus 1. In our sense, the index of G by S is 2. That's it. That's the claim. Now, assuming minus 1 is not here. Okay, minus 1 is not here. You might have remember, see that this is just happening because if I start with P, suppose I have chosen P greater than 0. If I start with P equal to 2, 1 minus 1, it's like just P minus 1 will be only 1. it is not interesting. That's why we have start with p greater than or equal to 3. And assume that for c, assume that minus 1 not in s, prove that each a, either a or minus a belongs to this. That's believable because yes, here I'm using p greater than or equal to 3. For c, s union as, that is g, because of index 2, right? This is for identity, this is for minus 1. And they say minus 1 does not belongs to s. So I can write, this is like 1s minus 1s. So I can write it 1 minus s. These are two index, index 2 means two cosets. One is identity coset, another one is this thing. So that's easy, right? A is here, minus A is here. This is what C. Okay. So far we have dealt with one nice question. Let's go. Okay, for the next thing. So far, so good. Okay. Here, there are things which I don't like to do right now, but I have to recall this because these are going to play a very important questions in our later section about Silo's theorem. So I like to recall it. This is basically again the number theory, number theoretical manipulation, the congruence equations. Okay, that's why I don't like to do. So let's recall a word on finite cyclic group. Okay, a word means just a passage. Basically, what is finite cyclic group? We know that is Zn. So we know that order is n. The number of generator of Zn equal to phi n. I will give you the end. I want you to prove it. Try it. I will give you the end. If A bar, usually I use 1, 2, 3, A, but sometimes A bar. If A bar is there, prove that A comma 1 equal to 1. I mean GCD. GCD of A comma 1 equal to 1. A comma n, sorry, A comma n equal to 1. If and only if A generates the entire Zn. If and only if. More generally, the subgroup generated in Zn, is the same subgroup generated by A GCD of n comma n. Okay, the same subgroup. That means the order of AK is n divided by GCD of n comma k. So when you prove GCD is 1, the AK, it will be like this in general context. That's it. Okay. So this is about the word on finite thing. Now let us go for UN. What is UN? UN, exactly I'm asking, taking A, Zn, such that the GCD with N is 1. And this is a group under multiplication. Try to prove that this is a group under multiplication, not only just a group, it's an abelian group under modulo multiplication N. And I want you to look at this. Even though I stated as an exercise, I like to prove. Let us see about U8. U8 is set of all A belongs to Z8, such that, let's say A bar maybe. Okay, let me use A only. N equal to 1, GCD of N equal to 1. Okay, we know that is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Up to 7, it's Z8. What are those are in U8? U8, 0 will not be there. 1 will be here, I will write. 3 will be here, I will write. 4 will not be here, but 5 will be here, I will write. 6 will not be, 6 will not be here, but 7 will be here, I will write. So U8 is actually order 4. Let us see under modulo multiplication of n. What is 1 square? 1 square is 1, which is identity. So order 2, I mean order 1. This is order 1. What about 3 square? 3 square is 9, but the congruent to 1 modulo 8. After dividing 8, you will remaining 1. So 3 order 2. Five square is 25, but that congruent to 1 mod 8. because 83 into 24 just you will remaining. So this is order 2. 7 square equal to 49 congruent to 1 mod 8, because 8 8 48, this is order 2. You see that every element, this is order 1, this is order 2, this is order 2, this is order 2. There is no order 4, so it is a 4 group order, but it's not cyclic. This is isomorphic to Z2 cross Z2. In fact, this is called Klein 4 group. This is called Klein 4 group. Okay, remember that even though we started with Z8, even though we started with a cyclic group, but that Unix group is not cyclic. This is called a unit group, Unix group. This is not cyclic, even though those for small number. Where is the problem? Problem, there is a 2. It's an even prime. Okay. And it will be interesting to ask for what kind of n belongs to natural number, un is cyclic. If you refer Dummy 10 food book, they have a partial thing. And also one can ask for what kind of n, un is like very nice thing. Very nice thing, what I mean? Product of very nice cyclic group. You can search in the internet if you're really interested. This is kind of a research problem. You can search how they prove and you will understand the basic structure. That's why, that's how research we will into it. Okay, we slowly go through the research by this. Okay, it may look very nice, I mean very simple. Nice, of course, but it's simple. But this question is not simple. You have to go through internet and see. If you're really a really interested student, will go and see for what sort of n. And there are a lot of restriction on then, especially whenever there is a 2, there is a problem. There is a problem. That's what I want to say. Okay. At least partially, I will answer for P, this is cyclic. I will not be able to prove here, but for P, it's cyclic. P on the prime. P is prime. So far about cyclic groups. Now I like to go for fundamental theorem of abelian group. I have still 15 minutes, so let us spend some word on, because today's class mostly theory, so I wanted to cover everything. Fundamental theorem of for finite abelian group, this is the one version. This is one such version. There is another very tough search version is there, which is require model theory. My guide in IMSC, Vijay Kodiyalam, he is very expert on giving this kind of lectures. He love to give classified things. He gave a lecture many times on this, and it is available in YouTube, I guess. I will give you one link. Using that link, you can follow. It is available in the net, I think. But anyway, let's see. Fundamental theorem of finite abelian group. Every abelian group is direct product of cyclic groups. Okay, let me explain you moment. Listen carefully. I'm not going to write anything, but these words are going to be very important. Listen carefully. This will change you, the entire perspective. Why I spend a lot of time on dealing with the finite cyclic group and infinite cyclic group? Because this finite cyclic groups are building blocks of finite abelian group. If you really wanted to understand finite abelian group, really you should understand finite cyclic group, because finite cyclic groups are the building blocks of finite abelian group. You must have seen this in this or that format, maybe some YouTube or somebody, someone of your professor must have taught you. But I'm saying that understanding the block will give you understanding of many things. Okay. So when I was a research first year student, we are used to do coursework. In my algebra 2, okay, just listen carefully. This is my experience. In my algebra 2 course, Professor Shauli Gunn asked me to present something. There were three people, me and two of my friends. She gave us some papers to give things so that it will help us to understand in research. But she made it such a way that our papers are interlinked. For example, I have to give the lecture first, then my friend Arpit will give the lecture so that it will link. And third, my friend Satyam will give. The Satyam lecture essentially is a Dirichlet problem. Okay, that Dirichlet problem he dealt with slowly in this way. I'm not here, kind of here, not tell you what it is, but I will tell you another nice problem and how people will approach the problem. Okay, what Satyam did in the class, converse of, he also did this thing, converse of Galois thing. Suppose if you have a finite Galois extension, people who knows Galois theory, listen this. If you know little bit also, it's okay. First, in a Galois theory, there is a question, okay, inverse Galois problem. Still it is open. I'm telling you, still it's open, but I will tell you what are the things they did. First, when you have a finite extension over, let's say Q, for example, let's say rational number, you have a finite extension, Galois extension, then you will have a Galois group. The question now asks the reverse. I will give you a finite group. Okay, the reverse question. I will give you a finite group. Remember, I'm not talking about Abelian group, but I will give you a finite group. Can you find a extension E over Q such that Galois group of E over Q is isomorphic to G? I'm telling you, this is still open. But what people did, and Satyam presented to us, first he proved for Zetens. If you choose G equal to Zetens, then it's true. And after that, using this theorem, because it's product of cyclic group, you prove for general finite abelian group. And people took a diversion, they proved for P groups. This is what Satyam presented to us. First, he proved for Zn, then he proved for group, then people in general, they proved for P group, then they came to Nelpotent group. This I don't know, some professor told me this, they came to Nelpotent group, then they could be solvable group. But for non-solvable group, it's still open and still believable, because Sn's n greater than equal to 5, it's not solvable. Who knows this terminology can see that. But if you don't know, leave it. At some point of time, you will know this kind of terminology. If you are in the math and you are teaching math, you will know this. Forget about that. If you don't know what is Nelpotent solvable, don't get disgraced. As I said initially, this looks very scary, but one can make it very simple. So I'm giving you a research glimpse. This is the research glimpse. This problem is still open. Okay. What I have presented, a very nice thing to Shaoli ma'am. Instead of Galois, just I have taken, instead of Q, I have taken Q extension. I proved that if you give me a group, there exists Q extension F, then E. This is Galois, and that is isomorphic to G. Not exactly to Q, but little above than Q, I have done it. Okay. So it is, that is what my presentation to her for exam evaluation. Okay. So it seems very easy things, right? But it has a very nice applications towards the very great theories like Galois theory. So actually, one of our professor, actually former head of the department, Professor Parameswaran Sankaran, used to tell those people, students, algebra is one of the subject, especially group theory, which bends to every other subject, which helps to every other subject. That's why I'm really liking this subject. And he used to tell all of his students, learn algebra well, because that bends to every, that means it will help every subject. So this is enough motivation. And now the general theorem of finite abelian group, fundamental theorem of finitely generated abelian group. This is not finite, but finitely generated abelian group. Vijay sir, Professor Vijay Kodiyalam has given three lectures, I think four lectures on this, how to come up with this theorem, this kind of theorem, you know, even very nice format. There he uses very nice kind of technique, matrix technique, okay? Module and matrix. He develops everything, whatever required, okay? So it's better to see it, okay? Now, finally, this question, which I like, I never seen, I have 9 minutes, which I never seen in anywhere, but I like to prove this. Actually, I will give you 1 minute to read this question. Please read this question and see whether if you understand this question, but the proof is 2 lines, it will be easy. I will give you 1 minute. I will read it for you. Let us read. Let G be a finite abelian group. And suppose there is a A, which is not identity, such that A lies in every non-trivial subgroup, prove that A equal to P for some prime number, and that G is cyclic of order A power of P. Okay. Let me read it again. This seems little bit hard, but it will be easy. Let G be a finite abelian group, and suppose there is a A, which is not identity, such A lies in every non-trivial subgroup of G, prove that the power of A, I mean the order of A is prime, and G is cyclic of order F prime power. Essentially what they are saying, prove that G is equal to P power some alpha, and order of A is nothing but P. Okay. Let's do that. We have powerful tools with that. If you take a finite abelian group that looks like Z P1 alpha 1, direct product, that is a fundamental theorem says Pn alpha k, Pk alpha k. Then you see that if this is alone a subgroup here, this is alone a subgroup here, this is alone a subgroup here, all of them are non-trivial subgroup. Suppose in this subgroup is a non-trivial subgroup, A is here, completely here, A cannot be here. So it says that G can't have more than one piece. If G has more than one piece, if A is here, because it's a property, A is non-trivial, A is here, A cannot be here. So that means G is isomorphic to just Z P alpha. That's it. That's it. That's what I wanted to prove. One. The second is I will leave it as an exercise. This is also easy. You see that A must be power of prime. You try it. It will be easy. A must be the power of prime. Okay. Fine. This is the question I wanted to leave it. And I want you to, maybe you can take a photo of this for further studies. This is the lecture I was talking about. Vijay Kodiyalam sir lecture is a correct follow-up. What I am doing now, correct follow-up. This is infinite groups, dealing with infinite groups. And there is a notes by Miller. There are nice problems that you can solve only in this area. Whatever I taught you, that is easy. You can look at it. Then look at NVHM questions, specific options. I just gave this because I wanted to motivate this. Whatever I'm doing is also related to NVHM, mostly related to NVHM questions. Okay. So I will finish the lecture here. And maybe, Guru Samyana, can we pass the recording so that we can go for question section?
Okay. I start the recording.
Okay, give me a moment.